everybody?
Good afternoon!
Or good afternoon. I've been getting so excited about us having a morning service that I forgot this is our last Sunday that we're going to have in the afternoon. So thank you for that, Kurt. A couple of few announcements.
Check your battery, please.
Oh, yeah, let me turn on this. So a few announcements before we get going. Beginning next week, of course, as I was just mentioning, and you may not have heard, we are going to begin our morning service, and that will be at 11 o'clock preceding the service next week. The Bible classes, all of them, including the youth, it shows in your bulletin that the youth will be a Zoom session. If not, it will be here live and direct from Kalmana Drive Baptist Church. So all the Bible studies, Dr. Dan's, all of them will be here at 10 o'clock next week. We have our business meeting will be on June 26th following our worship service. And then we are also coming up on the week of July 25th through the 29th. We are going to be having with Kalmana Drive Baptist Church Vacation Bible School. And I know there are still some needs there that we need for that. And if you can contact Pastor Shane about your willingness to serve in that, if you can, that would be greatly appreciated. Other than that, let's just begin the service with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we just thank you this day for the opportunity to be worshiping. We know that in many countries of the world that's not possible. And we pray, Lord, that as we are here, that you would touch us in a mighty way as we worship your name, and that as we study your word, that you just be with us in our fellowship together. We ask all these things in the precious name of Jesus, and everyone says,
Amen. Amen.
Please stand for our worship.
All right, good afternoon again, church. Please join us as we sing, Lord, Reign on, Reign in Me.
Thank you.
Hopefully everybody had a wonderful week. Praise God that we can all come and worship freely under this beautiful sanctuary. As we go to our next song, it's a nice oldie in the sweet by and by.
Thank you.
forgot to mention, but I've got we're blessed this morning to have with us Writer Yoshida. So he's here visiting from Hawaii. So Writer, glad you can make it this morning. It's a blessing to have you here. Well, this morning we're going to examine the life of King Asa of the southern kingdom of Judah, who enjoyed a faithful relationship with God for much of his life. He's one of at least seven men in the Old Testament that are described at least once, and sometimes more times in their lives, as the Lord being with him. And when the Lord was with him, King Asa was successful. Successful, that is, in terms of how God defines success. And you know, that got me thinking, with him being successful and all that, what am I doing as part of my relationship with God? Perhaps there's things or actions that I need to incorporate into my life so that my life can be successful in the way God is thinking, and that is to be serving God for his purpose. Asa was the third king of Judah, who reigned for 41 years, beginning about 910 BC. And in contrast to some of his predecessors and the neighboring king of Israel, King Asa honored God through his removal of altars and idols. He directed his people to be obedient to God's commands and laws. And the first 10 years of his reign were very peaceful. You can read about that in 2 Chronicles 14. And during that period of peace, King Asa fortified the cities of Judah with walls, with towers, with gates and bars. Asa recognized that Judah experienced a period of peace because simply Judah sought the Lord. And as Judah was being fortified, it prospered. But soon after, Judah was eventually challenged by a major attack from King Zerah, a Cushite, who was the king of Ethiopia. And 2 Chronicles 14 says that King Zerah had a formidable army of thousands of troops and 300 chariots, which just seemed overwhelming to King Asa. And in the face of that attack, potential attack, King Asa sought God's intervention. And God responded by enabling King Asa and his troops to soundly defeat the Ethiopians. Well, perhaps, following King Asa's faithfulness to God and his successful relationship with God, the prophet Azariah paid King Asa a visit. And he delivered him an important message that's recorded in 2 Chronicles 15, verses 1 and 2. Spirit of God came on Azariah, son of Oded. He went out to meet Asa and said to him, "Listen to me, Asa and all Judah and Benjamin. The Lord is with you when you are with him. If you seek him, he will be found by you. But if you forsake him, he will forsake you." Now, if we skip down a few verses from there, beginning in verse 8, when Asa heard those words in the prophecy of Azariah, he took several actions. Let's look at them. He took courage. He removed the detestable idols from the land of Judah and Benjamin and from towns that he had captured. He repaired the altar of the Lord. Verse 9, then he assembled all Judah, and he sent the people from various communities who had settled among them and came over from Israel when they saw that the Lord was with them. And then he assembled, and we see in verse 10, they had assembled in Jerusalem in the third month of the 15th year of Asa's reign. And there was a huge sacrifice of cattle and sheep and goats And then in verse 12, and then get this, they entered into a covenant to seek the Lord, not just King Asa, but the entire kingdom of Judah, the God of their ancestors, with all their heart and soul. Can you imagine if that would happen in America today? If we sat down and we said, we're going to make a covenant with God that He is the Lord God Almighty and we're going to follow Him. That's what they did. And then in verse 14, they took an oath that said, with loud acclamation, with shouting, with trumpets and horns. And all Judah rejoiced about the oath because they had sworn it wholeheartedly. So it wasn't just a big show. They actually believed it. That's what they were behind. They sought God eagerly, and He was found by them. So the Lord gave them rest on every side. And then in verse 16, King Asa, get this one, this got close to the family. He also deposed his grandmother from her position as queen mother because she had made an image of worship of Asherah. And so King Asa, even though it was family, he cut it down, he broke it up, he burned it. And Asa says in verse 17, Asa's heart was fully committed to the Lord all of his life. He brought into the temple God the silver and gold and the articles that he and his father had dedicated. Imagine all this. So the first 34 years of King Asa's reign were a testament of how a faithful relationship with God works for one individual and the nation. King Asa regularly communicated with God. He asked for God's guidance, and then he followed His directions. As a leader of his community, King Asa got rid of idols and anything that dishonored God and led his people to commit their lives to God. What distinguished King Asa was an important phrase that we see in verse 9 of 2 Chronicles 15. The Lord his God was with him. King Asa demonstrated then that he had a strong relationship with God. King Asa heard and he responded aggressively to the instruction in verse 2 of 2 Chronicles 15:2 that we read earlier. The Lord is with you when you are with Him. If you seek Him, He will be found by you. But if you forsake Him, He will forsake you. Well, how does the 34 years of King Asa's reign compare with the recent history of the United States in terms of our relationship with God? Let's quickly scan some of the actions of our country between 1962 and 2022. 1962, the Supreme Court ended school prayer. 1963, the Supreme Court ruled in favor of abolishing Bible reading in public schools. And let me be quiet and let Claire run us through some history. So we can see from there, just from those actions, if those actions aren't enough, all of those actions are contrary to God's word and God's instructions for us. And that isn't enough. There have been numerous mass shootings that have been made by people in numerous public places. Here's some from 1995 all the way through today. So even with a quick review, it doesn't take too long for you and I to recognize that America as a nation has struggled, we have failed, and we have left a relationship with God over the past 60 years. In contrast, for 30 years, the southern kingdom of Judah was faithful to God, and they experienced peace. And when challenges arose, King Asa sought God's guidance. You know, I could pontificate, and so could you, and speculate about how and why America as a nation has drifted away from our relationship with God over the past 60 years. There's a simple truth. Our nation has forgotten God's instructions that are found in God's Word. We've walked away from honoring God, and we've stopped asking for His guidance. I know our national leaders didn't call you and I up and say, "Hey Jim, what do you think we ought to do next?" I know that isn't the case. But we did elect our leaders, did we not? Doesn't matter what party it is. We elected them, and they in turn appointed people who took many of the actions that we see. Some were actions certainly by individuals. But just as King Asa did, we also must view God's instruction in 2 Chronicles 15:2 on a personal basis. Notice that God's instruction to King Asa by the prophet Azariah, it offers encouragement. And at the same time, it provides us with a warning. The Lord is with you when you are with Him. If you seek Him, He will be found by you. But if you forsake Him, He will forsake you. I don't know about you, but the first part of that, I'm really happy about that. I'm really encouraged, because in the seasons of my life, when I'm seeking to live for God's purpose, despite the challenges that I face, I experience peace. I experience a success that I think God is looking for me to have. Have you seen that in your life, that occurs? But when I forsake the Lord, it's different. If you do a word study on the Hebrew word azav, which is translated as forsake, in 2 Chronicles 15:2, we see English meanings like loosen, like leave, like relinquish, fail, and of course forsake. So if we leave, loosen, or fail in our relationship with God, God will respond similarly to us. In the seasons of my life where I chose to leave my relationship with God, my life was frankly more stressful, more complicated, sometimes a lot more lonely, and I must say frequently an uphill battle. Why? Because God allows us to make and live with the consequences of our personal decisions, particularly when His guidance or involvement in our lives is ignored and our relationship with Him is loosened or left. You might be thinking, "Yeah, but Jim, hold on. God promises that He will always be with you." And you're absolutely correct. Praise God. There are numerous passages in the Word of God that describe that promise of the Holy Spirit and how the Spirit dwells within those who have a relationship with Jesus Christ. Let's take a look at one, John 14:15-17. "If you love me, keep my commands, and I will ask the Father, and He will give you another advocate to help you and be with you forever, the Spirit of truth. The world cannot accept Him because it neither sees Him nor knows Him. But you know Him, for He lives with you, and will be in you." So God resides in the heart forever in every believer. who, for every believer who has a relationship with Jesus Christ. Amen? But God also allows us to make our own decisions, doesn't He? He gives us the opportunity to make choices and our own preferences for daily living. And if we choose to keep God away from our decisions, our choices, and our preferences, you know what? We're on our own. And if we do ask God for His guidance, maybe we do, pray, and then we turn around and we see signs and directions and we get guidance from the Holy Spirit to do it, but we still do what we want to do, then we're on our own. We don't hear Him because we, not God, have turned on the mute button on our TV remote. You ever hit that accidentally when you turned on the TV and you accidentally hit the mute button? That's, to me, the way it is. The voice of the Holy Spirit is there. It's there forever for every person that has a relationship with Jesus Christ. But we don't hear His voice because we're too busy seeking our own agenda and following our own preferences. Jim, that sounds awfully harsh, doesn't it? Are you sure that's how it works? I could rattle off a bunch of personal experiences about what happened when I didn't listen, much less ask or follow God's direction. But let's get back to 2 Chronicles 16, which describe a significant change in King Asa's relationship with God. War had broken out in the 35th year of King Asa's reign over Judah. And the following year, Baasha, the king of Israel, went up against the kingdom of Judah and fortified the city of Ramah to prevent anyone from leaving or entering the kingdom of Judah. Well, King Asa, he had a great idea. He decided to pursue this. He pulled out some silver and gold from the treasury of the Lord's temple and his own palace and sent it over to Ben-Hadad, king of Aram, who ruled in Damascus. And King Asa said, "Let's establish a treaty between us, just like your father and my father once had. You take the silver and gold, aka a bribe, and in return, you break your present treaty with King Baasha, so he will withdraw his troops. Is that a deal?" "You betcha." So what happened? We learned, if you read in 2 Chronicles 16, you keep reading on, Ben-Hadad, he agreed with the king. Of course, he was going to get a bribe, and he sent his commanders out against the towns of Israel. They conquer a bunch of them. And when Baasha heard this, he stopped building Ramah and abandoned his work, which was threatening King Asa. So then King Asa brought all the men of Judah, and they carried away from Ramah stones and timber that Baasha had been using, and then he built up those two communities. Mission accomplished. What a plan. Everything played out just like King Asa hoped it would, except for one thing. King Asa received a visit from Hanani after all this, the prophet, who delivered this message that's recorded in 2 Chronicles 16, verses 7 to 9. At that time, Hanani the seer came to King Asa of Judah and said to him, "Because you relied on the king of Aram and not on the Lord your God, the army of the king of Aram has escaped from your hand." And then he goes back over in the next few verses about, don't you remember 24 years ago what happened when you called on the Lord, you were in trouble, there were all those troops from Ethiopia, and you asked for God's help and He gave it to you and you forgot that. And then he closes in verse 9, "You have done a foolish thing, and from now on you will be at war." So So from the king's perspective, he was downright successful. The bribe, everything worked just like he hoped it would. But God wasn't happy with that choice because King Asa did not seek God's direction. He didn't seek God's direction. He didn't seek the intervention, potentially, of God's power. The prophet Hanani reminded Asa again of how that contrasted with what King Asa had done 24 years before. So by leaving God out of the picture concerning a military situation, King Asa had forsaken God. And in response, there were consequences. Well, things went from bad to worse. King Asa had Hanani thrown into prison because he didn't appreciate the negative review he got from his own seer. At the same time, chapter 16 says that the king brutally oppressed others as well. And 3 years later, King Asa contracts a serious foot disease. In the 35th year of his reign, the 39th year of his reign, and the king sought advice from physicians, but he didn't ask for any wisdom or guidance or healing from God. Asa continues to forsake God, and 2 years later, he dies. The experience of Asa, the king of Judah, provides some valuable clarification in my mind concerning how our relationship with God works. And if you are not sure where this instruction, whether or not it's even relevant to you today in 2022, remember the instruction in Hebrews 13, 7 to 8. Remember your leaders who spoke the word of God to you. Consider the outcome of their way of life and imitate their faith. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. If the Lord is with you in your life journey and your relationship with Him, you will experience success. God's version of success, not yours and mine. You can expect challenges, but God will take you through those challenges so those storms of life can be used for His glory. But if and when we drift away from our worship of our God, we forsake His guidance and direction, He will allow you to live with the consequences. He will always dwell in you, but you will not receive His direction and the peace that otherwise could be gained through an active working relationship with God. Why? Because you're not listening. Because sometimes we do it. We just listen to our own preferences, and that's what we pursue. Praise team can come forward now. So let me ask you today, this morning, where are you in your relationship with God? If you've forsaken God and you walked away from Him, let's say for a long time, or perhaps you don't have a relationship with God at all, there's wonderful news. There's good news. It begins by your repentance for all the things you've done wrong. It means if you can express your faith in Jesus or renew your expression of faith, knowing that Jesus provides you the forgiveness of sin from His death on the cross, and asking God to lead your life. And with that beginning, God promises that He will dwell in you to guide your life. We have the Word of God, which enables you to build on that initial relationship and discover what God's purpose is for your life, what to do, what not to do. And the promise of the Holy Spirit living in us reminds us that God will guide our daily lives. Some of you may have a different story. Perhaps you have a strong relationship with God, but for one reason or another, You've got one foot in, and you've got one big foot out of that relationship. The extent of your commitment depends more upon the circumstances in your life rather than your striving to maintain a strong commitment for your life to be used for God's glory. If that's where you are today, return to the Word of God to rediscover God's direction and purpose for your life. Don't just read it anymore. Look for the application and pray for understanding so you know what to do next. The Lord is with you when you are with Him. If you seek Him, He will be found by you. But if you forsake Him, He will forsake you. You know, I prayed this morning as I went through all of this passage from 2 Chronicles. In fact, I've done a study of the other parts of the Old Testament where it describes the Lord being with various individuals recorded in the Old Testament. And I sensed the Holy Spirit speaking to me and saying, and I want to share with you what I think I've listened and heard from the Holy Spirit. And it's a simple two-word instruction. Clean house. Clean house. Ask yourself, how much time do you spend communicating with God and seeking His guidance concerning all the issues that face you in your life and all the activities that you're engaged in? Another question, are you in the Word of God seeking God's direction for daily living? Or are you just winging it on what you think makes sense? Are those instructions that you receive from God, are you seeking to integrate into your home, your marriage, your family, your business, your investments? Are you sharing God's promises with the people in your world, your family, your neighbors, your children, your grandchildren, your business partners, the customers, your friends, your neighbors? Are you in fellowship with other members of this church and the body of Christ? I ask that particularly those of you who may be watching. You may be comfortable at home, but are you there encouraging in the church? If it's not this church, some other Bible-based church, where you seek to encourage. We're instructed in the Word of God to encourage one another. That's our brothers and sisters in Christ. We're there to celebrate their successes, to get next to them during their trials, and offering help when they're in need. You know, remote relationships with all the technology, they're a wonder what we can now do, isn't it, with all the technology. But they can only go so far. And so how are you supporting and seeking opportunities to respond to the mission statement of this church, which comes from Matthew 28, go and make disciples of all nations in the name of Jesus Christ. Bottom line, are you focusing your life to be used by God for His purpose or your purpose? The Lord is with you when you are with Him. If you seek Him, He will be found by you. But if you forsake Him, He will forsake you. Please stand. This morning I'd like to close our brief study of 2 Chronicles with an instruction that God gave to Moses to have the priest give to the Israelites. Let me share that with you. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make His face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn His face towards you and give you peace. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
And with that, we say amen. Please join us as we sing the last and final song, Living Hope.
Break the chasm.
Church family, both here and afar, and all of this we pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.